it going, everybody? My name is Brian, also as Brian. Welcome back to another video. Today we're talking about Code Vein. Code Vein, a game I was looking forward to last year, but it got delayed until this year. And we have not heard a word about Code Vein since July 2018. From all that time that was passing, did we hear no news? But we did know that it was getting delayed because the team wanted to work on it a little bit more from the feedback they got from the fans. And then after 10 months, almost a year, we finally got some news on Code Vein. They released a bunch of information, new gameplay, they fixed some stuff and now runs more smoothly than ever. Code Vein is a new IP from Bandai. The same makers that worked on God Eater is making this project called Code Vein. It is a Souls-like action RPG heavily inspired by anime. I like Souls-like game, I like a Dark Souls series, I like Software's formula, it's great, it's fun. There are other Soul-like games that are not from Software that are actually really, really good. Each time I play a Souls-like game, I see how different it is from the actual Souls formula. I want to see what they add them to be more unique. And there are some pretty interesting stuff about Code Vein that really do differ from the normal Souls-like. So in this video, we're basically going to talk about all about Code Vein, the characters, the gameplay, the mechanics, the environment, just all overall my thoughts on what I think about Code Vein. I'm 2 weeks late, but that's how I do it. You probably know this information already. You probably don't know some information here. But if you're here and you just don't care, thank you for watching. So without further ado, let's get started. Let's rock. Code Vein is set in a post-apocalyptic world where you play as a revenant. A revenant are vampires. Humans turn into revenants in order to survive in this world. They have supernatural power but lose their memories from when they were human. Since they are vampires, they need blood to survive. And when a revenant does not get in blood, they turn it into a lost. The enemies in the game. There are different types of enemies, different shapes of enemies. But all these enemies are referred as lost. In order to stay a revenant, they need to consume blood beads. This keeps them sane, their bloodlust stable, and prevents them from turning into lost. This mysterious fruit that grows on plants called Blood Tear Springs. Now this fruit gets harder and harder to find each day, but the protagonist has the power to restore the Blood Tear Springs and acquire blood beads. Now that is the overall plot for Code Vein. Of course, the same as the God Eater games, I'm not too worried about the story. They will deliver a nice story with some decent characters. The way Code Vein will tell its story is through cutscenes. And as the gameplay that we have seen so far, we have seen a lot of cutscenes. And I can't wait to see the full story of Code Vein. So we're going to talk about the characters of Code Vein, mainly the main characters of Code Vein, the ones that will be important to the story. And I want to give a spoiler warning because I will talk about the characters in the backstory. And if you don't want to get spoiled of the story of the Code Vein story so far that we know, it's probably best if you skip to this part of the video so you won't get spoiled. But pretty much all the information was given from the trailers and from information given by some articles. The hero of the story. Now the background story for our character dies and gets turned into a revenant. And how he dies and how he turns into a revenant, aka a vampire, is still unknown. Now the protagonist has the ability to revive Blood Tear Springs and produce blood beads. There are major events that happen to the protagonist early and that probably lead to this ability that he has. The protagonist also has the ability to see the past of the lost. And since they are the protagonist, we are able to change their appearance, their blood veil, and their weapons. But overall, the protagonist will be the one to drive the story forward. Io! And she looks waifu material. So Io is a mysterious character that wakes up the same way as our main character and knows the protagonist has these special powers. Very little is known about her and looks like she has no memories of her past and about her current revenant self. She doesn't know how she got here, everything is unknown, but I'm pretty sure the protagonist will help her remember all her memories with the ability he has. But Io is a companion you could take on missions. Overall, her design is pretty cool. I like her scarf, her hood, it looks very nice. And of course, her appearance looks amazing. Then we got Louis. He calls himself Louis, but it looks like it should be pronounced Louis, but we're gonna call him Louis because that's how he calls himself, so shit. So Louis is a leader of a revenant faction in search for blood beads. So he's the type of character for justice that seeks justice and wants to look for blood beads in order to keep all the revenants sane. He is also another companion you're able to take on missions. He is strong, he's experienced some fighting the lost. And the voice actor of Louis, it sounds pretty nice. I like the way he sounds, the nice English voice actor. He also has a sister named Karen, who is a nurse that the protagonist meets early on in the game. So Yukumo is the senpai of the group. He is a person everybody looks up to, and he cares about his fellow teammates, his revenants, the people around him. He's very caring. But that's pretty much all we know about Yukumo. Very little is known about him. But he is very close friends with Louis. Hopefully we'll see more character development for him and see what this character is all about. So Mai is another waifu, and Mai takes care of her brother Nikolai, another character. They're both just roaming around the world trying to survive. And all Mai cares about is her brother. She would do whatever it takes to keep him alive, but very little is known about Nikolai, and as well as Mai. Maybe they're from another faction of a revenants, maybe they're runaways, but they are also in search of blood beads as well. But as Mai as well, she is another companion you're able to take on missions as well. So Jack is a character the protagonist meets in the beginning of the game. And Jack is a special type of a companion that you're able to take on missions on only on special events. This could be the case that he probably might be an antagonist of the story. He as well as the leader of a revenant faction. He has a deep connection with the protagonist early on, and he's given a mission to find the successor of the heart from the piece of the queen's body. He is given the revenant hunter title because he hunts revenants who turn into a lost. Eva is another leader of revenants from another faction, and Eva is in bad terms with the faction that Jack is part in. But later on they bury the hatchet in order to work together because they both have the same task on finding the successor of the heart. And as well, she is also a companion that you're able to take on missions, but she is a special type of companion. Jack and Eva are most likely going to be the antagonists of the story. Probably might not be the main antagonist, but will be an antagonist of the story. But will most likely work together against our protagonist. So we could pretty much assume that the queen is the main antagonist of the story, or it seems that it looks like she is the main antagonist of the story. So the information on the queen is that she is a super soldier created by a faction of revenants, a super soldier. But this queen is a special type of revenant. She never gets hungry, she never gets tired, and she's very powerful. But she was being experimented on. She broke free and started to cause a ruckus. And pretty much Jack and Eva's task is to find the successor of the heart from the queen's body. And we give information that Selva and Louis have known each other back when they were classmates, prior to the events of the main game. And pretty much we could assume that the protagonists get the ability to revive the blood tear springs to produce blood beats, and probably to see memories of past revenants. Probably gets it from the protagonist draining the blood from the queen's body. But that's pretty much all the standard information for the queen. As well as another mechanic for Code Vein that we're able to have an affinity level with these characters. Probably every time we talk with them, probably every time we take them out to missions. Basically increasing our relationship with these characters. But I wonder how far these affinity level will be. Will we get a unique cutscene for these characters? Probably a resolve with these characters. Probably their own unique mission. But overall, these characters seem promising. I can't wait to see more later on in the future. So Code Vein's gameplay is your standard Souls-like game. You got your light and heavy attacks, and you're able to change these combos together. You got your roll, which you're able to use to dodge enemies' attacks. You got parries and backstabs. Now when you parry or backstab, it does this little cool animation of your character using their blood veil and doing a really cool animation, draining the blood from the enemies. It's a cool animation, it looks badass, but there are in some areas where the camera does get a little weird. If you are in like a cramped place or you're near a wall, the animation does look weird, but you are able to turn off this animation off if you want to in the main menu. So it's nice that they give you the option if you want to keep this animation every time you backstab or parry it, so it's very cool. Of course, you got your stamina bar when you use heavy or light attacks or even dodge, it uses the stamina bar. You got your healing items where you use to heal, and you got your checkpoints. And these checkpoints work like any other Souls-like game. Every time you rest in this checkpoint, all the enemies around the area respawn. Of course, all your items get refilled. So these checkpoints are exactly like bonfires in Dark Souls, or any checkpoints in any Souls-like game. And also in these checkpoints, you get to level up your character. You can also travel to different types of locations. Now these are the mechanics that differ Cold Vein from your regular Souls-like game, and has some pretty interesting mechanics too. Now the first thing we'll look at is the focus bar. Now what the focus bar does, when this bar is full, you're able to launch your enemy up in the air and do an air attack or a launch attack. And when you do this launch attack, you drain out blood from your enemies. Now how this bar is filled is when you get hit or you evade attacks perfectly, your bar starts glowing and starts shining blue, and as well as your character starts shining blue. And it's another interesting thing is that not only do you have this focus bar, as well as the enemies from the game have this focus bar as well. We have not seen them do any special type of attack or air launch attack on your player or on the character, but it'll be interesting to see if they can do that as well, make things more challenging, more interesting in battle. Now gifts are the special abilities in Cold Vein. You're able to equip 8 gifts in total, and you're able to customize which gifts you want in each slot. To use these gifts, you use Ichor, and you gain more Ichor by sucking blood from your enemies using your blood veil. And each different types of gifts use different amounts of Ichor. Of course, it's different from powerful ones to weak ones. The cooldown is different for each one. Some of these gifts are used for buffs on your attacks. They give you elemental buffs. They do special attacks. Some are long range attacks. Some give you boosts on evading. Lots of different types of gifts. But these gifts are different depending on what blood code you have. Now blood code are classes in Cold Vein. We have fire. This boosts your melee combat and raises abilities based on strength and dexterity. Ranger. This code excels in providing support and defenses buffs with gifts. Now caster is for powerful attack type gifts that can be used from a distance. And we have berserker. Now berserker is mainly relying on strength and endurance, and is low on Ichor stock but can be offset with heavy armor. So those are the different types of blood codes we have seen so far. And each time you equip these type of blood codes, and it changes the different gifts you are able to use. Of course, there are going to be more blood codes in the full game. And it's a very interesting mechanic in this game, because later on when you acquire different types of blood codes, some might not fit your style, or maybe some others in the future when you progress through the full game, you might unlock some more classes that fit your style. And as well, each different types of blood code will determine which types of weapons you will wield. So you're able to experiment with different types of blood code to see which one fits your style. And you're able to switch these blood codes on the fly. You don't have to go to a checkpoint to switch it. You don't have to go to your home base. You're able to switch it on the fly. Now leveling up in this game is interesting. Like other Souls-like games, you level up an attribute for your character. You can level up strength, dexterity, health, endurance, etc. In this game, you don't choose the attribute you use to level up. You just level up your stats simultaneously. But every time you level up with your blood code, it increases the stats for that blood code you have. It all depends on the blood code you have that determines your build. We haven't seen that much information seeing the leveling up system, but this is pretty much how it's gonna be. And to level up your character, the currency we will use is haze. And the other way to attain these hazes, like any other Souls-like game, is by killing enemies or bosses. Now, Blood Veil in Cold Vein is your armor. That's gonna be the one that represents your character as your customization style. There are 4 different types of Blood Veils. We have the Ogre, the Stinger, the Hound, and the Ivy. The Ogre type Blood Veil is the traditional style for the Revenants, and you're able to drain out blood from your enemies using your right arm. And the Hound is a Blood Veil that looks like a simple jacket, but when you attack with it, the sleeves of the jacket turn into 2 hounds. The Hound's Blood Veil is pretty badass. Next is the Stinger Blood Veil. The Stinger is a trench coat type armor. If you want to drain out blood from your enemies that's long range, you're able to use the Stinger to drain out blood from your enemies from far distance. The Ivy is the one that I think I will main in Cold Vein. Now the Ivy is a scarf type blood veil. You're able to put claws underground and move it around and use the spikes to come out of the ground and stab your enemies, and you're able to drain out blood from that way. Honestly, this blood veil is pretty cool, and I'm pretty sure this is the one that I'm going to main. It looks pretty badass. Of course, there's going to be different types of blood veils in the game. It's going to have different colors, different armor. Of course, each blood veil is going to look different. It's going to have a different type of drain attack. It's going to have different stats. But overall, the blood veil seems like a pretty cool mechanic. And when you use the drain attacks, every time you hit an opponent when you drain out blood, that's going to increase your Ichor mechanic for your gifts. Now, this is the main one the Cold Vein team is relying on, the buddy system. Of course, like other Souls-like games, you're able to take out companions on missions. Of course, in many other Souls-like games, it is optional. In most of the Souls-like games, you are playing alone. But at this one, when you are playing Cold Vein, you are going to be accompanied with a buddy. And of course, the characters that I mentioned before that are going to accompany you are Io, Luis, Giacomo, Mia. Now, of course, some special events will occur that you'll be able to take Jack and Eva on certain missions. So the buddy system is there to help you, I guess, make things easier. Sometimes your companions will give you buffs. They will heal you when you are down, and you're able to heal your companions as well. The buddy system seems like an interesting mechanic. Of course, from time to time, I would like to play alone. I'm pretty sure it's confirmed that you're not able to go on missions by yourself. The only way for you to go by yourselves is if your companion dies in a mission. Of course, speaking of the buddy system, there's also online play in this game as well. You're able to invite your friends and play together, just like Dark Souls and Bloodborne. So I like that they added that mechanic. Of course, customization is a big part in RPG games, and especially for me, I love customizations, especially the ones where you're able to make your own character, customize them, choose what weapon they wield. I like that. And here, when you're creating your character, you are given many options to make your character. You're able to change its face, its eyes, put scars on them, put some accessories on them, change their clothes, and you're able to combine two different types of hairstyles to make it look like your own. So I like they added a lot of options for your customization. And of course, you're able to change what type of weapons you have. Of course, you got one-handed swords, two-handed swords, spears, halberds, two-handed hammers, bayonet rifles. And that's pretty much all the weapons that we're able to wield in this game. Of course, each weapon is going to have its own moveset. It's going to have different stats. So the one thing I do want to talk about briefly is the visuals and the environment of the game, how it looks. Because I think it has some pretty nice visuals. So first off, I want to say the aesthetics of the game look pretty nice. It has that cool gothic look. It's anime. It's set in the post-apocalyptic world. There's destroyed cities, destroyed buildings in the far distance. It looks pretty cool. And the enemies of the game, there are different types of enemies. Some are big, some are small. Some look pretty fucking badass. I can't say that it gives me the vampire feeling when I see these enemies, because these enemies do not look anything like full blood rampage vampires. They do not look like vampires at all. I mean, some do give that feeling, but not a lot, not most of them. I gotta say, the game does look like it runs a whole lot much better than the previous builds. Of course, they were gone almost a year, so of course they had to look a whole lot better. And it actually kind of does. The 3D anime models look good. The clothes look good. The way they move is good. And I gotta say, the look on the blood veils, the look on the clothes, it looks very nice. I like the armor designs on the blood veil. I love the mask of it. There's different types of masks. They have teeth. It's just a nice visual to look at. And of course, every time you equip different types of blood veils, they have different types of armor pieces, and each one looks very interesting. Now, of course, you're able to customize your character in many unique ways. You know, build the character however you want. But overall, the visuals and the aesthetics, it looks pretty nice. Now, the environment of the games, we have seen many different types of the areas of the game. Hopefully, they have not shown every area of the game. I'm pretty sure they have not. But overall, the locations do look decent. Not something outstanding like Dark Souls, the Bloodborne, or any type of like Souls-like games like that. But it's not bad. It looks pretty nice. But overall, those are kind of all my thoughts on Code Vein. I am excited about Code Vein. There's a lot of good things about Code Vein that can make it a really, really good Souls-like game. The story, I'm not too worried about, and the story will do decent. The gameplay itself looks like it got a whole lot harder. From the previous builds, it did not look like it was a challenge. It did not look like the enemies were aggressive at all. If the game is hard, I like that. I like games that are hard and are challenging and just have fun with the game. And it looks like this game could be that type of game. But yeah, that's overall my thoughts. I can't wait to get my hands on Code Vein. Can't wait to see more stuff on Code Vein. That's all. Thank you guys for watching. My name is Brian. I'll see you guys next time. Later.